5 days. Let's take one after the other. It looks like y'all are running out of ink to make it a little bit bold for the eyes. The number one process or plan that he uses, doubt. I say what?
Doubt.
Could you imagine Jesus walking in the sea? And the disciples recognize him, knowing fully well that he has not died yet, and they say it is his spirit. And when they move from that spot of doubt, panicking, one of them that is so bold, Peter, said, okay, if you say that's you, can I come? And it's Jesus. He said, yeah, it's me. Come. As boldly as he used to be and continued to be, he stepped on the sea and was doing his work until he started looking at what? The waves. He started looking at the waves, comparing the waves with himself. Instead of looking at the waves and looking up to Jesus, the maker of the waves. So the process the enemy uses to bring doubt in you, to doubt the ability of God to see you through. That's one process. Even Christians, even seasoned Christians, comes to a point in their life that they doubt. Why? Why do we doubt? In case it doesn't happen? I've been in a meeting that I was ministering, the Holy Spirit took over, and the Holy Spirit told me what to do. I almost doubted to do it. Until it dawned to me that all I am is a vessel. Say what God says you say and leave the rest to the Lord.
Amen.
And I went ahead and did that. After a year, the news started coming of what the Lord did. Being in confirmation of what the Lord said. So doubt sets in as a process to disablige of God's plan, of what God wants to do. Or God already done it, and you've seen the benefit, and along the way, you start doubting, is it really? How many of you have had that experience of doubt in your lives? That's right. And I call those things the little foxes that does what? They find. When we hear about the little foxes that spoil the vine, we don't even bring it closer to when we doubt God. Because the vine of our Lord Jesus Christ in you, doubt spoils. Let's go to the next D. Discouragement. Hallelujah. makes you look at your problems rather than at your God.
Amen.
Discouragement makes you look at your problems rather than who?
God.
Wow. How many of you have been discouraged before? How many of you, as you're sitting here, are you discouraged? Thank you. God bless you. Thank you for telling the truth. When we are through, you'll be out of it. Hallelujah. God will elevate you from the level of discouragement to the level of trust. Discouragement is another process the enemy uses. If you look at Numbers 13 and 14, what Israel went through, and the Lord spoke unto Moses saying, verse 2, send out men that they may search the land of Canaan. This is the land that God brought them all the way from Egypt. They went through snakes, went through desert. The women never changed their shoes. Their shoes never worn out. The women I'm talking about. Praise the Lord. I like God to give my wife one shoe that we never wore out. So we have some more space in the closet. The shoes never worn out. They saw and experienced all this goodness of God. And all of a sudden, when Moses sent them to go and check out the goodness of the land, 10 of them got there. They said, "How? We saw the descendant of the Goliath, our father David killed. They are still waiting on us to revenge." They are still waiting on us to revenge. But they brought some grapes, good things. But thank God for Caleb and Joshua.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Thank God for Caleb and Joshua. That was why the message I preached some time ago, I said, Caleb's faith is mine. It's a fact that they saw the giants. It's a fact. It's a fact that the place is fortified. Everything they say was a fact. How does the fact contradict the nature of God? How will the facts, something you're looking, this is the facts, true, numbers, they're not telling lies. But how do you compare it with the nature of God? So they believed the facts and got discouraged and abandoned the nature of God, which is God Almighty, God who put the facts together. God who removes the facts when he wants to. God who blesses anybody he wants to bless and no one will stop him. God who took them all the way from the Red Sea and they came on the dry ground. All these things fooled their faith. Word was spoken, water came from the rock and they drank. All these things, they lost their testimony and take the process of discouragement. And when Caleb and Joshua was telling them, the other ten said, don't listen to them. When 10 are against 2, that tells you that democratic process is not godly sometimes. They could have casted, they could have voted. Three of them vote, no, we're not going. And the only two say we are going. And if it's democratic process, they will not go into Canaan. That's the process the enemy uses. The next one. Diversion. Makes the wrong things seem attractive so that you will want them more than right things. Sarah, if you look at Genesis 16, God said, I will do this. The enemy throws the wrong one to you. You grab. Do you know that anything God says is going to do, spoke to you about it? The enemy heard it too. Devil did what? He used to be in heaven. He used to be more preferred than you and I. He had a position like a prime minister in heaven. Prime. He understands the spiritual things more than we do. So he said, okay, since God said, I'm going to give you a farm, let me throw Ishmael in there. He diverted the eyes of Sarah to see the maid to be the viable option. When Abraham fell for it, it cost Sarah, Abraham, problem, and it's causing the whole world to be a problem in the Middle East. Diversion. That's another process the enemy uses to step you aside from God's plan. The fourth one, delay. Makes you feel like a failure so that you don't even try. Spies. When what you are asking from God delays, the enemy will say, it's not going to work, don't even, you don't have a chance. You don't have a what? How many of you have been to where you find that you feel that you don't have a chance? You feel that way. You don't have a chance. That's right. And you look back, nobody talking to you. You feel that you are done. You feel defeated. Makes you feel like you're failed so that you don't even try. Devil use that process. Remember, God will never do anything until we fill in the gap. That's the gap. That gap that is there, you and I had to fill it for God to get to the other side of the need. Remember that? And how do you fill it? Hallelujah. Amen. Your faith is the bridge that 18-wheelers go through. Amen. Your faith is the bridge that the speeding train goes through. Amen. Your faith is the bridge that all these heavy acolytes can go through. When you let your faith in God and move it, and unshakable. Don't feel defeated. Because Jesus has defeated the enemy. He took the key. hell away from him. He went to his camp and see them jittering. He said, give me the key. Give me that title of the money. I've redeemed them. Now by my name, when they say my name, you the Satan will bow. So your mouth becomes the bridge that God accomplishes his purpose. Amen. But when you keep your mouth shut and feel defeated, God will be looking at you. Yeah. Because he cannot go above his principles. His principles is you form the bridge that carries you through. Amen. Do you know that when Peter was going to the beautiful place of worship, at the beautiful gate, when they saw the cripple who was begging for alms, the bridge between that man being on his feet and stop begging for alms is Peter's faith. The man was expecting the dollar to flow. Thank God, to be poor sometimes is good. Hallelujah. Because when you are poor, your faith will rise up. Do you know that those in the third world countries, they have more faith than us? Because they don't have everything they need, and they have to trust the Lord and believe in him for everything. If Peter had a grain that day, easy thing, and he goes to the temple to minister. But thank God he didn't have any. He said, silver and gold have I what? Yeah. But in the name of who?
Jesus.
Walk on this bridge.
Yeah.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
The man got up. Wow.
Hallelujah.
Immediately 5,000 gave their life to Christ.
Amen.
Because of that word of faith. Some of you have words of faith that will bring souls to the kingdom.
Amen.
But defeat you feel, discouragement you having, will make you speak out. The fifth one. Delay. Delay makes you put off doing something so that it never gets done. Some of us like to delay, be late in things. You procrastinate. How many of us procrastinate when to get off from bed? That's right. You procrastinate when to get off from bed. If it's the day you're going to church, you'll be late. The enemy will keep you there. It's raining. Why not? Today will not make you not to be a Christian. It's cold out there. Yeah? If pastor asks you, say, well, it rained. Delay. Devil always finds things that will occupy you so that you'll get delayed from being in the plan of God. Let's look at Hebrews 4:7. Hebrews chapter 4 verse 7. Again, he limited a certain day, saying in David, today, after so long a time, as it is said, today, if you will hear his voice, do not harden your heart.
Amen.
A lot of people go to hell because they want to delay the process. They will hear the gospel. They don't want to give their life to Christ. They continue delaying it. They say, oh, we are young. I'm still young. Let me enjoy a little bit. How many of you heard about the worker that just died, 40 years old? A well-known young man, actor. That's right. Call a worker. 40 years old. at the prime time of his life. If he doesn't know Christ, he was delaying. Devil uses that process. Say, hold on, at least when you get to the age of whose age will you say? 50 or Pastor Lawrence age. Then you can think about Christ. And when you use that, you don't know that death is at the door. That is the process. But sometimes Holy Spirit wants to move you from poverty to riches. He said, remove the old this thing in your vineyard. Mind the little money. Say, remove it. Give it away. I want to open doors. You hang on to it. You hang on to it. And making it difficult for God to open those doors for you. Delay. Seven. The five D's. Process. The enemy uses it. Once you're a Christian, he applies this process to you. Applies it very well. You doubt, discouragement, diversion, defeat, and delay. But if you can master these forces, these little foxes, I call them foxes, and don't fall a prey to them, you'll be victorious. You walk in the level of understanding of God that many will never experience. But if you let some time, they will hold you down and you start going round and round. That's why you're still looking like a babe in the things of God. So this morning, body of Christ, how many of you is ready to let these little foxes go down the drain? Be on your feet, let's pray.